Hello, I'm Buster Edwards. Keep on
running. You won!
Then it's a quick pay to taxi. You probably never heard of me, but back in 1963, I became one of the most popular personalities of my time.
I want those hooligans nailed to the floor.
You see, me and my wife, June, well, we was often a bit stuck for cash.
Do what?
Borrow it from a bank.
Well, I do borrow from banks. I mean, that is my job.
I mean, with their permission.
But all our lives, we'd worked for the good life.
He's on about this dream all the time.
What is it? Elizabeth Taylor's jewellery?
It's the Royal Mail train. Carries £1 million on a bank holiday weekend. Now remember, I love you.
And we're going to nick it. £1 million.
Oh, Buster, don't go. I'm frightened.
You can live like a king in Mexico on a couple of grand a year.
I mean, that is the good life, that is. That's what he worked all them years for. Going local, down in Acapulco. If you stay too
long, yes, you'll be going local, down in... It's all right, June, he's just overworked.
It ain't home, it never can be.
No, but this is our dream, this is you and me, it's what we both work for.
June, God's sake.
It's only because I love you so much.
Isn't that great? The Mindbenders. Right now, boys and girls, we're very lucky because we have, from the £4 notes, Phil Collins. Phil, an unusual name for the group, I think.
Yeah, well, there used to be five of us, Tony.
Really?
Yeah.
That's a fascinating story, Phil. I expect you'll want to join the lads right now, won't you?
Yeah.
Yeah, lovely. Well, indeed, right now, here is Phil and, of course, the £4 notes and their latest record, which I know is going to do very well. You're going to love it. It's called Two Hearts.
There was no reason to believe. How does Julie kiss?
She kisses very well.
Thank you very much.
And then so does my wife.
Train robbery in Britain was the largest cash theft in the world. Altogether, £2,600,000 was stolen. Today, Thursday, the 16th of April, 1964, came the reckoning. Record criminal sentences were dealt out. Seven men, each going to jail for 30 years, were described by the judge as an intolerable menace to society. The robbery in August of 1963 was carried out with a commando-like precision and daring. The cash wagon was silently discharged of its contents in a very short time. The first break for the police was the discovery of the gang's hideout nearby Leatherslade Farm. Part of the gang are still on the run, among them the believed ringleaders Bruce Reynolds and Buster Edwards.
I got involved in about 2 years ago when I got a phone call from Tony Smith, who's my manager, who had had a script sent to him from David Green called Buster. And at that time, I didn't really know who Buster was. So he said he'd read the script and he thought it was great and he felt that I should read it. So I did read it and I didn't finish. I mean, I didn't stop reading it. I mean, I just, what was normally happened with scripts is I lost interest after about 30 pages. I never bothered to pick it up again. But with this script, I kept reading it and enjoying it, and I could see myself doing it.
Well, Bobby, can we see Phil by the door, please?
Yeah, just finishing.
I'm being made up, darling.
Michael. Right, here we go. And action!
Half a dozen stamps. And two premium bonds, please.
You ready, Phil?
Well, I've gone ready, right?
Michael?
Oh, yes, all right, then.
I didn't really do any research. I mentioned to David that shouldn't I meet Buster, at least, and what I felt was just try and pick up any idiosyncrasies that he might have that I could work into the film, that people wouldn't know were his idiosyncrasies, but I could stand up and say, yeah, that's spot on. And in fact, the first time I met him, rather, was in Genesis concert in July. And the only thing that came across to me then when I met him was how enthusiastic, bubbly, friendly, cheerful bloke he was. He had a lot of energy.
When you're on about business, it's fear, excitement, everything rolled in one, and not in the stomach, and a beautiful, fantastic feeling. And you go with this feeling. You go with a feeling that you're going to get away with it. No one expects to get captured because you wouldn't be a thief if you thought you could get captured.
I suppose in a way we was all leading an adventure. I don't really think that anyone particularly had the amount of money in their mind. It was just the fact that we were going out on what was essentially a great wheeze.
It just feels musically that, that yes, as a bit it works like that.
Yes, okay,
and then,
fine.
And we'll try it anyway, and it just doesn't work anymore. We have to do it again, all again.
It's going to drift out a bit again.
And the blisters are starting to come.
I've managed to come in at a certain level doing things, which, you know, actors strive for years to do and without any training, you know, so, I mean, I'm very lucky as far as that's concerned. But the reason for doing it is just really, initially, was just to see if, as a challenge, and to clear my mind of other things. And it really is, and it sounds stupid, you know, even though there's tons of hanging about, you know, and getting freezing cold while you're waiting for the clouds to go, you know, so you can do one 10-minute, 10-second piece, I still enjoy it.
Turn you back to camera, Phil. But other side to camera, Phil. That's it.
The film started as an idea some 5 years ago. The writer Colin Schindler and myself were fascinated with the great train robbery of 1963. And out of that robbery, as we started to research it and look into it, we found this remarkable love story between Buster Edwards and his wife June. And of course, it's okay, the Buster who now sells flowers outside Waterloo Station in London.
Somehow get the back down more smoothly if we can.
In what way?
It took a bit long to get down, I thought, that time.
Yeah, we just lifted up earlier.
Fine, OK.
And if maybe, I mean, if you weren't there...
Your priority is get hold of a bag and get it into Phil's hands straight away.
I received the script of Buster in 1984 at the Oscars, it was, actually. And I was staying in an excessively posh hotel in Los Angeles. And a load of scripts had come. And they were terrible things, like romantic comedies, the sort that Glenda Jackson and George Segal did in the 1970s, you know. Please. And they did them very well, but please, who wants to do them now? So then in amongst them was this, and it was just wonderful. I just thought, oh yeah, great. It was such a great story, and so, and it was funny and touching and interesting because it was real.
It was a bit awkward sometimes when Buster was there because you are playing someone that is actually real and is actually still around. It is difficult, I suppose. I mean, it's only my impression of how he is, how whether he was actually as cheeky and as happy-go-lucky as I seem to make him. We'll never know.
We have been without water for 10 days. We have struggled across 200 miles of desert to bring you this message.
Oh, yeah? What message is that, then?
It says, two cotton chips and heavy on the vinegar, please.
That's some sort of relationship that's a little bit weird. I mean, he says he feels, you know, by playing, while he's playing me, he feels like he is me. And we talk together and we've become quite close. It's really a little bit of a friendship that you couldn't believe could happen, you know, as a star talking to a flower seller.
Here we are in fabulous Hollywood, the Ocean Way Recording Studios, recording what we hope will be a hit record.
Well, there's no easy way to understand it, but there's so much of my life in her. And it's like I planned it, and it teaches you to never let go. There's so much love you'll never know, 'cause she can reach you no matter how far, wherever you are. Two hearts, but living in just one mind, beating together till the end of time. Well, you know we're two hearts, living in just one mind, together forever, until the end of time. Ooh.
Phil's wonderful. I mean, he's not a rock star trying to be an actor. I mean, he's an actor, you know, and he's got all the instincts of a good actor. I mean, he's great, I think. And he's such a nice bloke.
You know, obviously, everyone says, what's it like working with Julie Walters, you know, and I said, and they're going to say, well, what's it like working with Phil Collins? And it's very weird to hear the other person talking about you when you're there.
but she did say that because I am enthusiastic about it, and you know, I've got, you know, childish enthusiasm for it, that that was sort of in a way rubbing off, you know, that you're so used to sort of being around people that are a little bit jaded and sort of, oh, I suppose we better do it, yes, now click on the emotions, you know, that to be around someone that actually really enjoys what he's doing, I think it rubs off on the crew, because we're having a great time. I mean, there's a lot of laughing. I mean, I would say this about anything I do, but I mean, I think if you do a lot of laughing, if there's a happy crew, then it shows in the film, you know. I was nervous about a few things. I mean, one, I said to David, listen, I'm not ready to do a nude scene, you know. My first film, I'm not really ready for this. I mean, it's great when you watch it on the screen and you pan back and you see 35 people watching it. It's very hard to do love scenes, you know, like, they say, well, everybody, even no matter how many you do, it's still getting into bed with someone that you don't really know that well.
I think you'd have to be mad not to be slightly, you know, embarrassed to begin with. But then you get over that and it's all right. And then it's the two of you against the rest, you know, so it sort of brings you together.
Got the real Bruce over there.
Not much older than all this, is it? Yeah.
Taking over.
Carry some money away, yeah. There's any of that.
I mean, this is the first time I've ever done that, to meet somebody who I'm actually playing. I was a bit nervous about it. I mean, I needed to know about him and me, how we sort of shaped up with each other, personality, type, size, everything else-wise, so I know how much of a job I was going to have to do to become him.
They made almost as good a job as we ever found this as we did finding the other farm,
brilliant,
I think.
Isn't it, eh?
It is, brilliant. Really, hidden away.
Yeah.
We got a train round here, we can nick.
Bruce is categorised in the film as being very suave, but he was the one that was organising the logistics of the crime. And when you meet Bruce, and I mean this in a nice way, that he actually seems like he's still a bit, he's still there, you know. When you see him, he's still, if you've got any ideas, you know, if anything that comes up, let me know. Larry, that we are all in the gear, and we have been rehearsing for 2 weeks, so if you've got anything on the cards, you know.
Yeah, well, we're ready.
I don't know.
Well, are you putting it on or top?
I'm taking it.
David?
Yep?
We can rehearse with vehicles already there, yeah?
Yes, please.
Right, Simon, let's clear then, please. Stand by for a rehearsal. Vehicles are already there.
I'll do it. Go up behind the glasses. Come on, Walter. Get out of the way. On you go. Right.
Careful, Bruce ain't got his glasses on.
Right.
Final shot coming up. Yes. So we should start on big.
Start on big, yeah.
And pull back.
Yeah.
Right, cut it!
But it's only a small thing, a small aspect of it, the robbery. It's really the relationship and the deterioration of their relationship with the advent of the money. That's when the rot starts setting in.
The most difficult scene, and the scene I dreaded doing most, was the miscarriage scene, because I'm pregnant. So I really didn't want to do it, although I knew how it should go, you know, so on the first take. I thought, your head sort of thinks, no, I don't want to go there, really. So I think, right, I'll use my technique. You know, of course, it was terrible. You can't, really. You've got to sort of use your own emotions and your own feelings. So, but once I'd let it go, you know, it was all right, and it was everything was great after that, because it was out of the way.
No. There's
a good boy. Hang on.
Oh, Jesus. I'm losing him.
I went into this film knowing 90% of it up front. I mean, I made a cassette tape of me reading all the other people's parts and leaving holes, which is fine. Which is good. Yeah, I just sort of sat there and I would fill in the holes, but leaving the right length holes is sometimes a bit tricky.
I went to bed, leaving Buster more or less to supervise the situation.
and he came in later on during the morning, probably a couple of hours later, and said that all the money had been sorted out and it was all there. And I asked him how much it was. He told me it was just over $2.5 million. And I said, are you happy about that? He said, I think that'll do nicely.
I wound up with about 152 grand. Which, I mean, I don't know, today's money, I think it's only about $500,000. What, probably more. But to her, June, it didn't really mean anything. It was paper. You know, you can't... You give someone a tenner, it's a tenner. You give someone a grand, oh, I'm a grand. You give someone 150 grand, you see, it doesn't mean anything. It loses value. It really does.
Well, there's no point in sitting on our arses waiting for them to come and find us.
Right, let's go. I'll get Fairclough to arrange for the dustman to come to make sure the place is cleaned up.
I think it's that pause and that.
Okay.
With more authority. Yeah. Even more authority.
Right, let's go. I'll get Fairclough to arrange for the dustman to come in. Make sure the place is cleaned up.
Right, we'll go. I'll get Fairclough to send the dustman in to make sure this place is cleaned up.
Everyone had made their own arrangements to leave there and called the Green Line bus. And we felt quite happy. He'd got a family, as I'd got a family. And I was seriously thinking, well, I'll put my boy down for Harrow now. That wasn't to be, but that was my thoughts in my mind at the time. And one really thought, well, that's the end of me as far as crime goes.
And Pete.
Oh, actually, hang on, we need Norma.
She's coming.
Oh. Apparently. Because I am undone.
I said to David originally that I would give me more direction than maybe he would otherwise normally give other actors, you know. After a couple of days, I sort of fell into it quite easily. But he'd always come up to me and he'd say, very quietly, he said he was going to, you know, he wasn't going to do it in front of everybody. Phil, you know, it's not good enough. He'd come up and sort of say, a little bit more, you know, a little bit more on that.
Just play it down slightly now.
15.
Just
try and
slightly down on it, yeah, so it's not
quite
so much. Just
20%
less.
All right. Well, I don't know how to do it, do I? I ain't never had a golden before.
Yeah, and I ain't never had a beard before. But you ain't seen me belly aching.
All right, Buster, I'll do your deal. You weed the garden, I'll weed your beard. It's just as overgrown.
Just get out there, you old rat bag, and do something.
And turn over. 308,
take one.
Just one mind.
The thing is that the script was written without knowing them at all as people. So it was debatable whether we should meet them in terms of working on the character or not beforehand. Because, you know, they might put you off the script, you know, because they might be completely different and all of that. So we didn't know whether we should. But anyway, we met them anyway at the do, you know, the pre-filming do. And so really the work on the character is done from the script, although it was nice to meet them, just to see that they're real and still here, you know, and I hope that we do them a service.
There were certain incidents sort of stand out. I mean, and sometimes it's scenes, you know, like there's a couple of really good scenes with me and Larry, which really you feel, I mean, I couldn't stop laughing on one of them. There was the dock scene where there's two of us walking on the dock discussing, do we really have to go to Acapulco, you know? I didn't even know where Acapulco was. And it's quite funny, it's sort of subtly funny. But when Larry was doing it, it was so good. I mean, I had a beard
fortunately, so they couldn't see me laughing. But it was one of those moments when you really think, this is really good, this is happening.
Franny is going ahead, just to make sure the old Bill ain't following, all right? She'll be in Acapulco in a couple of weeks.
Oh, Acapulco. Where's that then?
Oh, Mexico, you ignorant sod.
All right, all right.
So when are you coming?
I don't know exactly. June 8's abroad. But you reckon even if we gave him the whole lot back, it'd still be no deal?
No deals, Buster. No deals. Don't waste your brain thinking about them. As it is now, we can't even get outside the front door. You can live like a king in Mexico on a couple of grand a year.
This is interesting. You see, this is what's called screwing up the actor's coat. Banging a microphone in. Finding out it doesn't work. Screwing up the actor's coat again. Putting the other microphone in.
That's hardly disturbed.
Hardly disturbed.
Hardly disturbed.
No. He says it's hardly disturbed.
Actually, it's better on that little thing you just had.
And there's the rest of us.
Highly disturbed. A lot of people say, when you know, weren't you bored and isn't hanging around driving nuts? But I found that there was enough of interest to do watching it being set up. And again, you know, the novelty, I'm sure, does wear off, and that's why people, you know, the hardened actors say, he'll learn, you know. But the crew were so nice to get on with. That's the thing. I mean, there was definitely a family vibe, so that's one of the reasons probably why we all enjoyed it so much. And it didn't seem to drag, you know, it didn't seem to get boring. So.
John's got to give a much closer shot because I've got a very close two shot I'm carrying here. He's got to get into there. Yep.
Mm-hmm. That's good. If he does it like that, the kind of wind, into the air.
All ready, Buster. We better go. The boat leaves at midnight.
How long? How long will it take?
I don't know.
Can you come again?
Can you come again? Buster, come on. It's getting late. He won't wait for you if you're not there.
It's very strange, you know, when you, I mean, on those kind of things, it's very personal. You know, how someone kisses, you know, is people kiss differently, you know how it is. And it's very different. How do you do that kind of thing, you know? And like the punch, you know, with the semen, do you go all the way, you know? Or is there a method of kissing in films that I don't know about that actually, I mean, at the end of the scene, unless you think, you know, what does he think he is, you know? I don't know, I only know one way, and that's to go for it, you know what I mean?
I've never felt that Phil needed help, really. I mean, I think he needs... All actors need to know that they can trust the other person. I think you've got to let them know that. I mean, especially in something like that's intimate and they're like a love scene, because they're vulnerable, you know? We all are, and so, I mean, that's all you do, really. Is make the other person feel safe and hope they do the same back. And I mean, he does. He's great.
Buster, come on. It's getting late. They'll go without you if you're not there.
Buster, don't go.
Kiss Nicky goodbye from here.
We've cut, Dave. Thank you.
Good, Tony.
Yeah.
That's a wrap.
There was a knock at the door, which was the police. And they had some excuse about someone trying to break in upstairs. And she said, well, you can't come in, because she didn't want the police to see me. However, they insisted that they come in to look around to see everything was OK. And they asked her if she was on her own, and she said she was. And we had a degree of understanding. Even today, I don't really quite understand it. But for some reason, I took all my clothes off and hid behind the sofa, which when the police came in and looked behind the sofa and saw me crouching there, my wife reacted in the obvious manner and said that it's her lover, her husband was away, and that's why she said there was no one in. And the police were very apologetic. They seemed a bit... really ashamed of themselves at busting in on us. And they said, well, we're sorry to disturb you, etc., etc., and they promised they wouldn't tell her husband. And with that, they left, and let's say shortly after as I left as well.
Feel the pressure back against the wall. Love is gaining on you. You're just about to fall. If you're afraid to love, afraid to take a chance.
My original intention was not to have anything to do with the music for the film, because I wanted people to sort of, to really just divorce themselves completely from my, that, from that side of me, and to really just concentrate on the acting side and sort of take that seriously. But the way it turned out, because of my, you know, my commitment in that area, I got Lamont Dozier, who wrote all the Four Tops and Supreme stuff in the 60s. He was a friend of mine, and so I asked him if he would write some songs. He came down to Acapulco with three or four songs that he'd written. The one that I liked the most, in fact, didn't have words. And so that weekend, I wrote some words, thinking, well, I'll write the words and then we'll get somebody else to sing it. And I thought, no, hang on, maybe it's better if I sing it. But it would have it at the end of the film, because that way they'd have seen the whole film with me acting before. So I kind of justified it that way.
You can hear the voices.
Submit.
Yeah. Let me try to get other people to sing the other songs. And it was a big, big problem. They see my name attached to something. They see the word film involved, and they immediately assume there's millions of dollars, you know. And everybody was asking arm and leg, so I ended up singing another one. And we actually got the Four Tops to come in and do one, which is great, because Levi Stubbs' voice is so perfect for that period.
Do the second chorus again, because you're a little far out, you know, man.
Start earlier. First time we see Mexico, palm trees, see Buster and June coming in to land with Nicky, arriving in the promised land, and the coordination of the movement of the plane and Bruce and Franny's car going to the airport to meet them is absolutely crucial to the opening of the sequence.
There, if you can hold it up here next to the camera.
Everybody, please keep quiet. This is picture.
The plane is absolutely perfect. It's hitting its mark every single time, spot on. The trouble is we can't coordinate the motion of the car and the speed of the car with the speed of the plane at the moment.
Pero lo que no quieren sentir es el
frío. Sí, sí, sí.
O sea, bueno, rápido. La velocidad es la misma para bajarla, pero no quieres sentir el tirón. Que no sea tan brusco el movimiento.
Sí, sí.
I've worked in tropical situations before, and there's nothing worse than working in a beautiful, beautiful place
Well, your brains are boiling inside your skull. You're trying to look the same as you looked 2 seconds ago. So there's people dabbing sweat off you. There's people trying to dry you out. There's people trying to keep your makeup going. There's people trying to stop noise. There's people trying to do all sorts of things. And what you're trying to do is hang on to not going mad and also do your job.
The pilot's doing an excellent job.
Camera's turning, camera's turning.
Gonna know what's hidden.
I mean, Buster will be all right, but not about June. A bit too far from the elephant in the castle for her, I think.
Yeah. No Bingo, no Mum. What will she do?
But he's gonna be hitching up with my wife to be a couple of tourists at the airport, which would be good. Everybody's getting a little cameos in. But, no, it's good to be in it. You've got to be in it somehow. Oh, you didn't want to be a policeman, did you?
No.
Nah.
You can hear voices leading through those warm
Latin nights. This is how you make up artists again. Yet again. We should clip together all these bits.
The same one. Oh, no.
No, I didn't give her time to put them back on again.
Mark.
And action, everyone.
Hey, over there, look. Hey, Bruce, hey.
Hey, how you doing, Sam?
This is me exit from the film game. I've had enough. I want to go home.
Please.
If there was any differences between me being me and the me going home during, you know, a night and my domestic hours, if you like, being different from the film hours, it's hardly much. Probably I'll ask the wife. She probably notices more change than I do. But I do remember actually my voice. I mean, I wouldn't go in character. It sounds a little funny to say that. But definitely my language is worse during the making of the film.
We just won the bloody World Cup! We are the champions! 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 We are the champions!
This is Norma. Norma Hill, she's available. Makeup only, of course, for makeup. Gets it off in the shower. And the makeup.
Next is five of you.
Okay,
just
so
relax and cool down.
I'll put
down.
This in the shade.
Yeah.
Hello.
Just
relax and cool down.
The summer of Flaverty.
While we were shooting in Mexico, Julie fell ill, and as a consequence, we had to reschedule everything.
We used the other makeup artiste, Aileen, who was Julie's makeup lady. And it's remarkable, she did look just like her. You know, she was sitting in the back of the car and it was far enough away. And she had the headscarf and the dark glasses on, which is what she was supposed to wear. She wasn't disguised just for the hell of it. And she was sitting there and we had a joke about doing all the love scenes again, reshooting the whole film with her as Julie. I don't know how keen she was on it. Oh, was your lucky there's no kissing and cuddling scenes today, Aileen?
No, you're lucky.
I'm lucky, am I right? How And I don't know if sometimes we made, didn't mean to, but June and Buster took out to be a little bit comical in Mexico, if only to get a point home. And I know June was very concerned that we didn't make him look silly, and I don't think we did. In fact, if anything, I think we made Bruce and Franny look silly because they were desperately trying to fit in, whereas June and Buster owned up to the fact that they didn't fit in and came back. So I think in the end, they're the ones that sort of leave with more pride.
There are a lot of people standing along the water's edge over where the boat is now. Are they our people or what? And turn over.
All good.
No, just wanted bits and pieces.
Been very involved with scenes of come and gone, you know. I've been naive enough to think when you shoot a film that what you're shooting gets used, you know. I don't think that they're going to take scenes out. And when I first heard that they were taking scenes out, I said, what do you mean? You can't take that scene out, that's great. So that's, that was the first, well, one of the second or third lessons I learned. But most of them are back in.
For a British film, which is a very large budget film, its scope is beyond that of the normal British feature film. We film in London and Mexico, and we film on two continents over a period of 3 years in the 1960s. So what we're dealing with is a high period piece. And I do mean high period. I mean, 1963 is a more difficult period to portray, I would suggest, than 1863, because people don't... If you could get the period from 1863 to 1866 about right, and people will accept it. Not necessarily they should, but they will. Whereas if you get 1 week, let alone 1 month wrong in the period between 1963 and 1966, then you're really getting the whole film wrong, because it's very close and people remember. We used a camera called a Steadicam, which is particularly useful in certain situations when you want to give an almost documentary feel to what you're shooting, a kind of feeling of being there, of not just sitting and observing performances and actors and situations, but of actually getting in with them.
You know, she's put in quite extreme situations, really, so you have to know what makes her tick in order to know how she'd react, even though the script is a huge clue. It's only writing on paper, so, I mean... So you do have to know that, yes. I mean, it's a very well-rounded character, so you have to get into it.
I suppose the most challenging scene in the film was the Mexican hospital, because we had to recreate it in England. It was particularly difficult for Phil and Julie because we'd been filming in the cold of November for some weeks, and suddenly they had to think hot. They had to imagine they were in 85, 90 degrees of heat, tropical heat at that, and they cope remarkably well.
Oi, are you listening?
Buster, don't. He's busy.
Leave off, June. Look, stupido, this little girl is ill.
Senor, all these people are also ill. You must wait.
Wait? How can we wait? Feel her, she's wet through. She could be dead before you get to her. Listen to her, just listen to her.
You are not in England now. You must wait your turn.
Buster, for God's sake. Give me a nicky and get out of here. Just go away.
Don't be stupid, June.
I'm not being stupid, Buster. We should never have brought her to this godforsaken place. Bad enough having her ill in this filthy hole without you upsetting the doctor as well.
Oh, my, that'd have been all my bleeding fault. Who'd I do it for if it wasn't for you two, eh? I mean, you were the one that was always on about having a house and a good life and all that.
Not here, Buster. Can't you see? Ain't worth a tin of beans here.
It was decided that we should have the spin sick on camera, you know, rather than just, you know, shying away from it and seeing me go, whoa. So Norma, the makeup girl, Norma Hill, available for makeup everywhere, she mixed up this fruit and veg, which is, I quite like sandwich spread and mayonnaise, you know, but she mixed up that with some fruit and the fact that I knew what it was supposed to be made it very hard. I was sort of shoveling it in. And I quite liked the taste, but because I was thinking about what it was supposed to be, I really sort of almost started to gag myself, you know, as much as I could in. And as you see, you know, it looks quite realistic. All the little chunky bits. But the adrenaline of doing it, I mean, David relates it to sort of having the deciding penalty in the last minute of the FA Cup or something. You just go for it. I ran across the street, picked up the thing, the dustbin. What would have decided where I was going to hit it. Didn't flinch either. Mark McBride came over afterwards and he said, I don't believe you didn't even look away. I just went for it. It shattered, all went inside for us. And I went round that like that to get all the other bits. It fell, I went straight in, got the dummy, straight out and out. And they chatted cut and all the audience applauded it. The coincidence we had the other day, we were doing a shot driving down the A40 where on the radio they announced that they found the farm, right? So we do a U-turn and say, that's it, we're nicked, you know, what are we going to do now? Anyway, as we were taking off in the car, we had this police car pulled up behind us because we had a light facing us, which was probably facing oncoming traffic. The policeman said, what are you doing here? So he said, well, we're filming, you know. He said, oh, yeah. What film's that in? Buster. Oh, yeah. Well, you're making a film about the great train robbers. All that stuff went down. Anyway, then we went in because he didn't want us to film until he checked it out with his superiors. And he said, have you met Buster? So I said, yeah. He said, we'll give him my regards, will you? I was the bloke that nicked him in Harrods for shoplifting in 1970.
And it weird.
Coincidence. Of all the policemen in all the world, we hitch up with someone and nicked him, you know?
In terms of getting into character, I don't normally just go off into a room and sort of do all that all the time, because sometimes it's easy to slip into scenes. But if you're expected to cry or something, if you're expected to produce emotions that aren't necessarily on the surface all the time, then you can't just sort of, the tears come, you know. You have to go off and for a couple of minutes or however long and hope that you can get it together.
And we had this market scene, which was very hot that day. And I had to, you know, slap her around the face. And she said, you've got to do it properly. I said, well, it's very hard when you really like someone to do that, you know, time after time. And she couldn't sit down because she was very pregnant. So every scene we did, every time we did the scene, from different angles, I whacked her. And my hand was getting sore, let alone were her cheeks, you know. I mean, slapping her around the face. Anyway, when it came to a close-up, and David said, I said, came to the part and I whacked her. I mean, I really did whack her and she almost fell over. And she came back up, she had tears streaming down her face, which she had anyway, because she's remarkable like that. But she actually came up with tears and she actually looked at me like, what the hell did you do? And I actually looked like, what did I do? I shouldn't have done that. Which is actually the right feeling for the thing, because the Buster would never hit, he never did it, June. And, it was a very special moment.
It was a very healthy life for the kids, and they got on very well together, being the same age, Buster's daughter. And we got on very well, you know, as a group. Obviously, you know, as time went by, I think Buster was under sort of pressure from June that she wanted him to go back home.
Me and Bruce sat down one day and worked out what we'd spend the week. And it was just absolute ridiculous money. You know. I mean, I had my money then was in a Swiss bank. And it was just going nowhere.
You're Buster Edwards. You got bleeding millions.
What's that?
Were you put something on the front?
No, he'll react to you. And I think, what you've done there, when you had him there like
that... even a bit more than that.
He'll react to it. When you got in there like that, you were too close and made it look like that. Because what you do, you got it like that, and you step back it, back, and then do it from there, and then go like that. And you come forward, see it. You come right forward, and with that one, that's what you go like that after the thing.
That was another first of mine in this film. It's the first screen kiss, first love scene in bed, first fight. Well, John Parrott, who was the seaman, was very good. I mean, you know, when you're doing something like this, you don't know how far to go. I mean, I don't know. I'm not trained. Do you hit the bloke? Do you really, you know? I mean, it looks terrible when you throw a punch and just sort of stop a little way. You know, when you see those bad fights on television, you think, oh, God, or the bloke snaps the guy's face and it's 3 feet away from it. So we said, no, go for it. He said, it hurt me. I don't matter. I can take it.
Okay, you drop your bag and go straight at him. Straight at him.
Now push him down, pull him down.
Watch yourself.
You alright?
Yeah.
Watch yourself.
Right.
I'm fine.
Kick it out though.
Welcome to Britain. where's my bag? And, you know, then David said, cut. And it was like, you're all right. And he was, you know, he said, yeah, it's all right, you can keep coming with it. And I didn't know how far to go.
I know you. You're Buster Edwards. You've got bleeding millions.
Oh, yeah, that's right, I forgot. Hang on, I'll have a look.
Very good. Going on.
500.
That was my very first stunt ever.
When I'm feeling blue, all I have to do is take a look at you. Then I'm not so blue. When you're close to me, I can feel your heartbeat. I can feel you breathing in my ear. Wouldn't you agree? Baby, you and me got a groovy kind of love.
When it come down to it, I mean, I come back, I was home a week, and I give myself up to the police.
I think that's a measure of Buster as the man that he came back to give himself up, because June wanted him to give himself up. I think that speaks for itself.
I suppose, if anything, it's a moral tale. I mean, it's a story, in the simplest terms, that shows that crime doesn't pay, and certainly didn't pay for Buster Edwards.
I mean, Christ knows what it's like to go to prison. Fortunately, I've never been there. But, you know, it must be very strange. And to come back knowing that you know, not even an if and a but knowing you're going to get put away. It's a brave man to do that for the woman you love. Harmonize on the piano, and I can't hear the DX.
When I'm feeling blue, all I have to do is take a look at you. Then I'm not so blue. When I kiss your lips, all this seems to matter. My whole world could shatter. I don't care. Wouldn't you agree? Baby, you and me, we got a groovy kind of love. We got a groovy kind of love. We got a groovy kind of love.
I can't dance either.